is Mark 33 through 5:20 in Mark. With many familiar parables, Jesus spoke the word to them as much as they could understand. He did not say anything to them without using a parable, but when he was alone with his own disciples, he explained everything. That day when evening came, he said to his disciples, "Let us go down over the other side, leaving the crowd behind." They took him along just as he was in the boat. There was also other boats with him. A furious squall came up and nearly swamped them. Jesus was in the stern, sleeping on a cushion. The disciples woke him and said to him, "Teacher, don't you care if we drown?" He got up, rebuked the wind, and said to the wave, "Quiet, be still." Then the wind died down, and it was calm, completely calm. He said to his disciples, "Why are you so afraid? Do you still have no faith?" Oh, there it is. They were terrified, and asked each other, "Who is this? Even the wind and the waves obey him." They went across the lake to the region of the Genesis. When Jesus got up out of the boat, a man with a pure spirit came from the tombs to meet him. The man lived in the tombs, and no one could bind him anymore, not even with a chain, for he had often been chained in hand and foot. But he tore the chains apart and broke the iron on his feet. No one was strong enough to subdue him. Night and day among the tombs in the hills, he would cry out and cut himself with the stones. When he saw Jesus from a distance, he ran and fell on his knees in front of him. He shouted at the top of his voice, "What do you want with me, Jesus, Son of the Most God, High God? In God's name, don't torture me." For Jesus had said to him, "Come out of this man, you unpure spirit." Then Jesus asked him, "What is your name?" "My name is Legion," he replied, "for we are many." And he begged Jesus again and again not to send him out of the area. You heard of the Bay of Pigs, right? This is where we're going. A large herd of pigs was feeding on the nearby hillside. The demons begged Jesus, "Send us among the pigs. Allow us to go into them." He gave them permission, and the impure spirits came out and went into the pigs. The herd, about 2,000 in number, rushed down the steep bank into the lake and were drowned. Those tending the pigs ran off and reported this in the town and the countryside, and the people went out to see what had happened. When they came to Jesus, they saw the man who had been possessed by the legion of demons sitting there, dressed in his right mind, and they were afraid. Those who had seen it told the people what had happened to the demon-possessed man, and told about the pigs as well. Then the people began to plead with Jesus to leave their region. As Jesus was getting into the boat, the man who had been demon-possessed begged to go with him. Jesus did not let him, but said, "Go home to your own people and tell them how much the Lord has done for you and how he has had mercy on you." So the man went away and began to tell in the Decapolis how much Jesus had done for him, and all the people were amazed. May the Lord add his blessing to the reading of his word.
I actually briefly considered using Bay of Pigs as the title for today's message, so I'm thinking like Mike, Lord help us. Can you imagine what that day must have been like for the disciples? Now they had spent all afternoon with the crowds, listening to Jesus teach in riddles. Their brains must have been fried, trying to follow all of his words, trying to tease out the meanings of each parable, trying to grasp what it meant for them personally and for the mission they were on. Jesus taught his stories right up to the very edge of their ability to even handle. Darkness has fallen. They think it's time for bed. And that's when Jesus tells them they're going to be pulling an all-nighter this time. They're going to cross the lake. I don't imagine the disciples were thrilled with this news. But how do you argue with the teacher? You don't. I imagine at least one disciple was grumbling on the inside. So as the sun goes down, down toward the horizon and past it, they climb into their boat, all 13 crowding into the same one, about 27 feet long, 7.5 feet wide. It's not the only boat in their party. Some of the crowd, some who had yearned to get closer to Jesus, who had crowded around to get the in-depth scoop, they're along for the trip. They cannot bear the thought of not seeing Jesus first thing in the morning. I wonder how many hours things were peaceful, uneventful, even dull, as they began that trip across the lake. I wonder, what was the first sign of trouble? Maybe the wind picked up a bit. Maybe a few drops of rain splashed on the bridge of Andrew's nose. Maybe a wave sloshed over the edge onto Matthew's shoes. And they knew this was no little storm. It was a strong one, lightning rolling back and forth between the black clouds, wind whipping the water into a frenzy. By the time Mark can even finish his sentence, it's already in full swing. Were the clouds visible on the horizon when they climbed into the boat? Did the disciples just assume they would miss them? What if they thought that the kingdom mission would exempt them from seeing the storms? They were wrong. Here it is now, crashing down upon them with everything that it's got, pounding them into the sea. They're shouting into the wind. It's stealing their words and sending them flying. The water is filling the boat now. And I picture Thomas, the eternal pessimist, realist if you prefer. He is probably the first to have the thought, this is the day we are all going to die, friends. Knowing him, he was probably the first to disregard group morale and announce that thought out loud. You know the kind. What a waste, they must have thought. Is this where the kingdom is going to end? With a few dozen skeletons on the lake bed? Or bloated bodies bobbing in the sea? They've left house and home. They've left friends and family to devote themselves to what they have been convinced God is doing, and this is all the thanks they get. Rained on. Is the kingdom going to get rained out before it really gets off the ground? Can even Jesus do anything about this? The healer of lepers, the dispeller of darkness, or will he drown too? The disciples scramble around the boat. Where did Jesus go? Is Jesus still in here with us somewhere? Did he fall out? No, there he is. And anticlimax. While the disciples have been rowing, Jesus has nodded off on a little cushion in the back of the boat. Maybe you'd hear him snoring if the wind weren't so loud. Here the disciples are, panicking, frantic, adrenaline flooding their veins, their hearts pounding like each beat might be their last, and the Savior is gone to bed. Do you think they were thrilled? Where is God in this storm? Where is God in this demonic whirlwind, this parody of God's fearsome presence? Where is the power of the kingdom? Where is the thought of miracle after miracle after miracle? Where is our protector, our refuge, and our trust? Well, there he is. He's sleeping in the back of the boat. As far as the disciples can see, when the storm gets rough, the God of their salvation is asleep on the job. And don't we sometimes feel the same way? Living this life, serving the kingdom, we run into our fair share of storms. Some are mild, some are strong. Few are Category 5 hurricanes in our lives. They enter to disrupt us, to throw us into chaos, to derail our calling. They come to dissuade us from the abundant life that God plans for us. They come to challenge our kingdom ministry. They come to turn our peace into panic, to strike fear into our hearts and drown us in all those burdens we cannot bear by ourselves. Now, I've faced my fair share of storms. You have too. Maybe you've gotten a call late in the night. There's been an accident, and you need to come quickly. Maybe you've watched the waves agitate as cancer slowly drains the life out of a father or a mother, a husband or a wife, even a child. Maybe you've woken up employed one day and gone to bed without a job that night. Maybe you've woken up with a house one day, and by the time the sun's gone down, you've got no place on earth to lay your head. Maybe you've lost all you have to a fire, earthquake, tornado, or the bank. Maybe the wind keeps throwing bill after bill after bill in your face, burying you until you gasp for air, fearing you'll drown in all your debts. Maybe life's roughed you up. Maybe your friends have deserted you and fight with you. Maybe you've been harassed or vandalized, or maybe everyone's against you and you'll worry that you'll lose all you've got. You've forgotten what happiness used to feel like. And you call out to God, and the storm gets worse. And you pray your heart out, and the waves hit your face, and the floor jerks out from under your feet, and heaven, all you can hear from heaven is the sound of rumbling thunder and rain. For all you can tell in those days, those hours, God must be asleep on the job. If you've ever felt like that, I know I have, then you can sympathize with the disciples on that frightful night. The disciples frantically wake Jesus. I doubt by that, Mark means a respectful whisper in his ear. Psst, Jesus, hey, we could use your help. No, I don't think it was like that. More likely, they're yelling. They're screaming. Maybe they dare to shake him by the shoulders. Wake up! They shout at their teacher. They ask, do you even care? We are being destroyed from the land of the living here. They wake. What do you think they expected him to do? Do you think they imagined that he would just be another set of hands taking a bucket, working to toss out water? Did they think he'd grab an oar and pitch in to make it to the other side before they sank? Or did they at least dare to think, maybe if he can make the blind see and the crippled walk, maybe, just maybe, he's not helpless in the face of all nature's fury. Picture this scene. As he stands, the wind messes up his hair. His robes are drenched, waterlogged. The boat is tossing and turning beneath him. He treats the storm like the demon it is. He rebukes it. His voice pierces the clouds as he demands of the Sea of Galilee, pipe down and put a sock in it! Congregational language, "Peace, be still." What kind of a man goes around yelling at storms? Who goes around rebuking the elements, trying to put God's creation on a leash, and succeeding? That sounds like the God of the Exodus. The God who rebuked the Red Sea and it dried up. He led them through the depths as through a desert. The God who saved them for his name's sake to make his mighty power known. And just like that, the raging, fierce wind grows soft. The topsy-turvy boat stands upright. The crashing waves lose their force and stop and drop. The clouds go find somewhere else to play. Brilliant starlight dots the once murky darkness. The Sea of Galilee smiles, adopting a calm and cheery demeanor every bit as majestic and magnificent as the scowl of that demon storm. Coming on so suddenly, the quiet must have been almost eerie. When you get used to the chaos, the cacophony of howling wind and tempestuous waves, well, their absence is rather unsettling, heightening the otherworldliness of what's just happened. It makes your hair stand on end. And there are the disciples in the boat. Hair on end, a chill down their spine, staring at Jesus. This familiar and yet almost alien man who tells the sea to jump and it asks how high. The man who can blow back the hurricane winds with the sound of his voice. The man who scolds a maelstrom like it's a petulant toddler with instant effect. What kind of teacher have they been following? This is beyond the territory of anything that they have known or dreamed. And how do you look that kind of power in the face when you've seen what he can do with just a couple words? What goes through your head at this point, looking at those lips that just commanded the weather, the eyes that saw through the storm? What do you make of this Jesus, whose job description is really starting to look an awful lot like your Maker's? What the disciples learned that day is that Jesus was in control that whole time. Chaos doesn't have the final word. The kingdom of God has the final word. Word, peace, be still. Now in any storm, it may look like God's asleep on the job. It may seem sometimes like he's deserted you, abandoned you. But I tell you this, when the storm has served the purpose for which he permits it, he can disperse it with a word. See, for all that seeming absence, for all his evident silence, God is in control. And not just some abstract God, some cosmic tyrant or divine butler, not some grand magician or some heavenly therapist, but the God whose autobiography unfolded on earth as Jesus Christ. The God who saves when salvation is beyond hope. The God who scolds storms into silent submission. That is the God who is in control. That is the God of the gospel. And if the disciples looked at this strange and suddenly unfamiliar Jesus, they must have waited with bated breath to see if he had any comment to make. Any grand lesson to unveil to them out of this. They waited. What is Jesus going to say? All he says are two questions. Why are you so afraid? Have you still no faith? Why all this panic? Why all this uproar? Why did you let the storm get the best of you? Have you forgotten that there's another way? All this teaching about the kingdom, and don't you get it yet? No matter how wet things get, there's not a storm in heaven and earth to drown the kingdom's sea. Don't you yet really believe that you're the ambassadors of God's rule? Can't you see that even Jesus with his eyes closed is a living and active Savior? Don't you trust him yet? How do the disciples react to him? They feared a great fear. As frightening as the storm was, there's something more imposing, more intimidating about their own mentor, their very own best friend. Jesus is no tame teacher. He's our protector, but the disciples are coming to realize he is not domesticated. He is not safe. They learned what C.S. Lewis knew. Who said anything about safe? Of course he isn't safe, but he's good. He is the king, I tell you. Not safe, but oh so very good. A fearsome savior, maybe, a live lion and no tame teddy bear, but a savior who calls us to faith and to hope and to love that outlasts all things. The storm is past. There's a great calm. The boat reaches the other side of the lake. I picture it as the hour right before sunrise. They aren't in Kansas anymore. They've left what today is called Israel and entered what today is the Kingdom of Jordan. Their boat has landed in the country of the Decapolis, near the town of Gadara and the region of the Gerasenes. All 10 towns were mainly Gentile, settled by Greek colonists. It's a very pagan place, one that might have made the disciples wonder, why are we being taken here? What is Jesus up to? No sooner had Jesus stepped out of the boat than he and his soggy, tired followers had work. Out from the unclean cemetery emerges a wild man, possessed by unclean spirits of immense power and number, thriving on the negativity of death, celebrating madness. Here's this man, unrestrainable, a tomb dweller, a zombie imitator extraordinaire. We have left the survival movie behind. And now we find ourselves written into a horror flick. Here before us is this man. He's the first century's Jason Voorhees. Here's Freddy Krueger. This is Dracula and Mr. Hyde and Frankenstein's monster. This is the nameless fool who haunts the tombs, who treats every day like a dark Halloween. What do you do when the monster presents himself out of the mists before dawn? What is Jesus going to do? He sees through this apparent monster. Outwardly, this man is fierce. This man is unconquerable. He cannot be tied down. He cannot be shackled. He cannot be chained. But inwardly, he's really more of a prisoner than most. He's no warrior fighting with sword and shield or machete. He's not launching gleaming arrows from a citadel. He is himself a lost battlefield, annexed and occupied by Satan's strike force, a battalion from Hell's Gates. And for all his wildness, well, he's oddly familiar. He's the perfect image of a sadly common reality. Look around the streets and you'll see plenty of people who built walls to hide their inner vulnerability. People who compensate for that inner sensation of weakness by being outwardly cold, aggressive, assertive, dominant over all and sundry. You'll find them in our prisons. You'll find them in our boardrooms. You'll find them in the church. To one degree or another, many of us have been in a place like this. How often do we pretend that the cure for our inner chaos is outward composure and control? How often do we let a past of being victimized compel us to overcompensate, to insist that in order to never be put in that place again, we'll seize the reins and become unchainable at any cost? The deeper our fears, the greater our thirst for liberation, the stronger our demand to set the terms for our future, to be accountable to nothing and no one. There's an adage out there: hurt people hurt people. How often do we wield woundedness as a weapon? How often do we lash out in vain attempts to solve or soothe the baggage we carry painfully inside our hearts and our minds? That's this man's story. Jesus sees him for the truth of what he is. This man is not the enemy. Jesus did not come to wage war against flesh and blood. This man is a lost soul, desperately needing redemption, needing true freedom, not from shackles on the wrist, but from inner occupation. Jesus is up against more than just one unclean spirit he finds. Legion is my name, for many are we. Comes the haunting voice. But Jesus conquers the unconquerable, not just outside, but on the inside, with one command: come out of the man, you unclean spirit! Jesus has confronted hell's army, thousands and thousands of demons, with a one line, and Jesus won. It did not take a prolonged siege. It was an order, not an option. So the man kneels. The man bows in worship and submission. The demons confess Jesus and beg for mercy, beg that this unexpected start of the kingdom won't mean their destruction ahead of the appointed hour. Jesus lets them take up residence in a herd of pigs, which get consumed in their destructive impulses, all 2,000 of them. But as for that man, you know, the one made in God's image, what's his story? Well, there he sits at Jesus' feet, the posture of a disciple, clothed and in his right mind, neither of which he was before. He's been changed. Talk about a message of hope. We all bear our inner scars and traumas. We all have our share of pain. At times, the biggest storm is not the one outside. The biggest storm can be the one inside. The storm or demon horde in our own soul. Maybe it isn't cancer that's afflicting us. Maybe it's depression or anxiety, whether the clinical kind or the more everyday type. Maybe on the inside we feel crushed and abandoned, isolated in our own numbness. Maybe everything we see is filtered through a gray and dreary fog. We might think, if only I could be strong, no abuse would. If only I could be successful, everyone would respect me. If I were feared, I wouldn't fear. In And so we make a Faustian bargain with the darkness. We overcompensate. We seize control. And we end up losing control where it matters most. I've been there. I think I have some understanding of this thing. There was a time in my life where I knew what it was like to hear voices. There was a time in my life where when I'd shut my eyes, I would see visions of hell. I can tell you what this man learned, what the disciples witnessed with their own eyes. The Jesus who scolds storms is the Jesus who expels legions. The Jesus who quiets the wind is the Jesus who quiets the discouraging voices in your own mind and heart. The Jesus who settles the waves is the Jesus who kicks demons to the curb. This Jesus is master of body and soul, of the physical and the spiritual, of heaven and earth and sea and all that in them is. And he is in control over the storms and over the spirits. He brings order and peace and wholeness to the world and to our world, to our souls. Like the storms of downpours and gales, so the storms of passions and sorrows will pass through. But Jesus can and will make them be still at the time of his choosing. He will make them pipe down and put a sock in it. And he invites us to just have faith in him. Faith in his goodness and his power and his wisdom. No. He's not safe, but he is the sanity of God in a world gone wild. He promises to clothe us in his righteousness and restore us to the only right mind we could have, the mind of Christ. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. That's a promise. You can bank on it. Now, when this man was healed, you'd think the townspeople would be thrilled. If they've got an ounce of humanity, they should be overjoyed. Something good and wonderful has happened to a fellow countryman. Even if they're selfish, they should at least be glad the scary monster is a monster no more. But they aren't thrilled. They aren't even happy. They don't care about him. They've written him off long ago. His good turn of fortune is no delight to their eyes. They look at him. What they see is the cost, the drowned pigs, the foregone revenue, the image of Caesar on metal. Outweighs to them the image of God making wind and dust into a miracle on two legs. The God of the Exodus has come to their shore to set the captives free, and they were afraid. Like the demons, like defective disciples, they respond to Jesus not with faith, but with fear. They find in him only a fearsome menace, not a Lord mighty to save and not to slay. And like the demons, the people of the capitalists are reduced to begging. They beg him to leave their neighbor, to pack up salvation and take it elsewhere. The kingdom is a disruptive thing, a costly thing, and they don't want the kingdom. They would rather evict the desire of all nations. Does Jesus stay? Does Jesus force himself upon them? No. No, he doesn't. Jesus turns around. He wades out into the water. He climbs back into the boat beneath the soft light of dawn. And yet there's one more act of begging. That ex-demoniac, the finally tamed wild man with control of his faculties now. Well, he wants what the demons fear, to leave this region, to be apostolic, to be on mission for the kingdom of God, even in strange and foreign lands, so long as he can be like the 12 and be with Jesus. That's all he wants. Jesus tells him, no, I have a better idea. Jesus has another plan for him, a place where he can be more effective, right there, right in his own neighborhood. Jesus sends him out to his own people to tell them how much the Lord has done for you and what mercy he has shown you. And that's exactly what the man does. Preaches to the whole Decapolis, amazing everyone with news of Jesus and the kingdom. Years before the Damascus Road, years before Cornelius the centurion, this former host of Legion, plucked out of impurity and chaos, this man set free from demons is the first missionary to the Gentiles. And he's a Gentile himself. He's the lingering witness in his land to a kingdom that's open to all. No matter whether you're Jew or Greek. And even if you've got a past that's packed full of demons. All he is asked to do is share what Jesus, the stiller of storms, the sanity of souls, has done out of mercy. He saved them for his name's sake, to make his mighty power known, to reveal the kingdom coming. Maybe in these days you're facing a storm. Maybe you're living with Legion. Maybe you're feeling swamped. Maybe you're breaking shackles and howling at anyone who comes near. But Jesus is the kingdom made flesh. Jesus is the salvation of God drawing close. Don't fear the storms. Don't fear the demons. Don't fear fear itself. Trust Jesus. Ask him to pilot you. He wants to make more of you than fish, more of you than a monster, more out of you than a battlefield or a capsized ship. More than a victim or a victimizer, he wants to make you a witness. He wants to make you a kingdom witness. If not out on the road, then right where you live. Right in your backyard. No matter what you've done, no matter who you have been, Jesus offers a new start. He offers new dry clothes. He offers a new life and a new mind. He offers his mercies new every morning to make his kingdom known in abundant life given freely for you. When the storms come, when the voices call, when the tides of fear and grief and anger rise, plead to Jesus. Beg mercy of the God of peace, the God of great calm, given in his time. He is not asleep on the job. He who keeps Israel neither slumbers nor sleeps. He's the risen sun. He's the living Savior standing in your defense, telling your storms, peace be still, and your inner darkness, come out, you unclean spirit. Of course he isn't safe, but he's good. He's the kingdom's king, I tell you. Amen and amen. Hallelujah. Let's pray. O God of our salvation, whom the wind and waves obey, who drives out thousands of demons with a single word, you are our salvation. You are our hope. Be here in this place. Don't let us ask you to leave. Don't let us fear what we need to trust. Your kingdom disrupting the chaos of our lives and turning it into the order of God. An order we don't understand. An order that may look like mayhem to us. But an order that makes us souls on fire for your glory. Shelter us in time of storm. Set us free to follow in your train. Let us be what you would make us. O God, our Savior, Jesus Christ. In your name we pray, asking that you would send us out wherever you have determined, near or far, to make known the mercy the Lord Jesus has had on us. The power of your Spirit, to the glory of God, our Father, who redeems us from all things. Amen.